Hey there, all you guys and gals! You head cats, cool kittens, and diesel comic disciples of cool. Welcome to Comixstravaganza Live. I am your host, the Guy Fieri of comics, John Pica, also known as Big Daddy Cool Johnny Della Rocca. Along with me, Darth Lee, Leanna Player, and Mr. Producer, do we have anything?
We're working on it. Hang on.
We have had some technical difficulties going live tonight. There we go.
Yay.
There we go. We are rolling and everything is kosher. We actually just did 7 minutes before we realized nothing was going out. So pretty boy Daniel Shoemake is here with us. And what?
What he said, oh. He's telling us what was wrong.
Oh, it was on the diesel-powered podcast you streamed.
Whoops.
Wow, that's weird. That's never happened before.
No, I don't.
That's really bizarre.
Well, we get to talk about everything we just talked about.
Yeah, we can.
A shark flew through, though.
Yeah, oh, man.
He came through. He was
that.
Tap dancing.
Yeah. Johnny was hula hooping.
Yeah, it was pretty.
You missed it.
It was pretty hot. It was pretty hot.
It was wild.
So tomorrow night, we'll pick it up right where we were. Thursday night in Nashville. Mad Donna's, Big Daddy Cool and the Bombshell Kittens, along with Vortech and Mr. Essential, the Carnival Fantastique, it's electro swing music, magic, burlesque, starts at 9, you want to be there, it's going to be epic. Then, this Saturday, Jackson, Tennessee, I want to do something like Burt Prentice. Tonight, this Saturday at the Nashville Fairgrounds.
As long as you're not doing Bruce Buffer, we're good.
Yeah, so, no, at Jackson, Tennessee, it's the Jackson Comic and Toy Show, hosted by Comic City Conventions. Go to ComicCityTN.com. Daniel, D. Volpe, Nancy Arch of Cosplay Collective, and Amy Sulam is going to be there. Amy's going to be hosting, emceeing the cosplay contest.
And you will probably hear her obliterate me live this time.
Yeah. So come out, meet them. I'm going to be on the other side of the state in Tullahoma at the South Jackson Civic Center with Tina Vita, Alabaster Glory, and Lynn Bryant as Lana Lamore. We're doing Swingin' at the Roxy. It's my full stage show. Music, magic, dance, audience participation. Tickets are only $12. You can get them at southjackson.org. So check that out and go. So, you guys, we were saying we've got gremlins. I'm blaming it on the long weekend, on the Labor Day weekend, because everything else that has gone wrong with my week so far has been a result of being off work Monday.
It's a blessing and a curse.
I blame it on the rain. I'm Millie Vanilli.
Blame it on the rain.
I really wanted to bust it.
Falling.
Anyway.
I just sang that better than Millie Vanilli lip synced it. Anyway, okay, where were we? So, we feel like our whole week is just wonky.
Oh, it's goofy anyway.
But Monday, we had an awesome event.
We did. We had a blood drive event.
Yes.
Yeah, tell everyone about the result of the blood drive.
Okay, so we had 37 appointments set. Out of 37 appointments, we had 27 people who were actually able to donate blood, which
That's
is
awesome.
Great.
That's great.
Really great. The goal was 20.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay. Yeah, because they give that cushion for people who have like low iron or low blood pressure, or they go through the questionnaire.
Or went out drinking last night.
Or went out drinking.
Or you probably don't really want their blood anyway.
No.
It's like Keith Richards.
Right.
Who gets his blood? Because he gets his blood changed
like
a Chevy.
I want Tom Cruise's blood, because that dude doesn't age.
Right?
No, there's something in the water, because him and Johnny Depp are from the same area of the world.
And Keanu Reeves. They don't age.
No.
Either they really are immortal vampires.
The Pharrell doesn't age.
He doesn't. No.
Well, he's still a kid. What are you
talking about? No, he's 40-something.
Yeah, but he didn't really hit it until recently. He doesn't count. I'm talking about people who've been around since the early 80s.
Well, Tom's had work. Have you seen
his teeth?
On his nose. Remember his nose from Risky Business?
No, but I remember his teeth from the outside.
Beat on him.
You remember how jacked up his teeth were? Oh my gosh, yeah, that was him.
I love that movie. See, there's one movie.
Yeah.
I've actually seen that one. Yes, I love The Outsiders.
So, okay, Blood Drive, you guys had a great... a great turnout.
Yes.
We had and some we great bands playing.
Yeah, we want to thank Paradise Days. We want to thank Amy Salam, who came out and did some stand-up. And we want to thank Fedora and the Explorers. I love you guys. And I want to thank the American Legion because they did provide a big spread of food for the event.
Oh my gosh, it was awesome.
Well, I had no idea until like the day before that they were even doing that.
And you had a great MC for the event.
I did.
And he was pretty awesome. But you know what the best thing about the whole event was?
What?
Watching Amy Salam suddenly realize, I can't tell that joke in front of a family audience.
Oh, I wish I had been there for that one.
Thinking on her feet.
I was giving blood while Amy was on stage.
She was great, though. She was awesome.
Well, you know what's funny? Because my mom was like, you know, I felt, because everybody kind of, like, after the band, everybody kind of filed out and was in there giving blood. So she was just up there, you know, telling her jokes. And we were trying to laugh as loud as we could so she wouldn't feel bad.
No. There were people there, and they laughed. They had a good time. And, you know, I did a little bit of magic and juggling, and we had a good time. It was a good event. And, like you said, the ladies of Post 82.
Yeah.
We heard they were just going to serve barbecue.
Yeah. Psst. No. They called all the other ladies, and they did a whole spread.
I mean, it was three conference tables long of food. It was like a church potluck.
Yeah. Like a Baptist meeting.
Yeah, it really was.
Southern Baptist prayer meeting is what that was.
So hopefully we'll be going back there for the cosplay toy drive.
Yeah, we'll be doing the cosplay toy drive there. I've already talked to them about doing that again this year. And they're interested in having my Swingin' at the Roxy show there.
Cool.
So we're going to be doing more with them. That'll be awesome. The other thing that Labor Day kind of threw us off on was DBRT and I didn't get to do new comics this week because, you know, family commitments, holiday stuff. So I brought along a couple of new comics this week. I went by the comic book shop just to show you guys a few things that are out that I'm interested in this week that we would have covered on Sunday. First is Tyson Hesse's Diesel Number 1. This is a crossover book.
This looks really cool.
Steampunk and diesel punk crossing over, kind of at the end of the steam era, and a diesel engine becomes sentient. It becomes animated, and it's all about that diesel engine, you know, kind of bursting into their steam-driven world.
It has an anime feel to it, and we were talking earlier when we thought we were live that it kind of has like a Avatar Last Airbender. That's kind of like what the art.
Yeah, the visual aesthetics, yeah.
Yeah, and it's really, really good. Like, I actually want to read this because of the artwork. It looks really good.
Well, when I'm done, you can have it.
Yay!
Now, the big release this week, and this might be the release of the year, is Star Wars Shattered Empire Number 1. This is by Marvel Comics. Of course, for those of you who came in late, you may remember about 2 years ago, a little company called Disney bought Lucasfilm. And about a year before that little company called Disney bought Marvel Comics. Fast forward to the new era of Star Wars canon, and Marvel Comics is publishing Star Wars Shattered Empire along with their mainstream Star Wars line, the Lando series, Darth Vader, Princess Leia, Chewbacca is coming soon.
Woo.
And this tells the story of what happened after Return of the Jedi. It starts with the Battle of Endor, and it tells what happens after, leading up to The Force Awakens. So, not only do we get to know what happened after Return of the Jedi,
we get to meet new characters.
We get to meet new characters that probably play a role in The Force Awakens. But the best part, it's in canon.
Yeah.
Now, I know that really hurts a lot of you who were into the expanded universe. Everyone who was a big fan of the Star Wars expanded universe. And look, there was some good stuff in there. The Thrawn trilogy, Courtship of Princess Leia. There was some things with the Yuuzhan Vong. All wiped away. Lucasfilm, Disney, Kathleen Kennedy announced last August, gone. No more. This is the new official story.
It's the real deal.
Yeah, the real deal. That's a big deal. Big thing. There's another novel that is releasing alongside this called Aftermath.
I'll probably read that one.
And it picks up at the same place but tells different aspects of the same story. So, pretty, pretty cool. That's it. Those are on shelves right now. Came out today, Wednesday, September the 9th.
Cool.
Nice. All right. So, let's get to the meat and potatoes of everything. We have got some questions from the congregation, and your prophets of pop culture will lay it on you. We're going to lay down a smoking groove so cool it'll make you flip your lid. Boom!
Boom!
All right, so Warner Brothers, Batman versus Superman, Dawn of Justice.
Here we go again.
It is now rumored that they are pushing for more Batman in Batman versus Superman. They're going back to film some more because apparently...
They're
going to
film up until the release date.
Henry Cavill's performance in Man of Steel and in Man from U.N.C.L.E. apparently just wasn't quite up to par, and they're not feeling confident in this Superman, and now they want to add more Batman.
You would think that they would have figured this out by now. Warner Brothers, you're a huge, huge studio. What is your problem this time? What is your problem?
This time?
Well, other than so many
Green Lantern?
Oh, yeah, no. Man of Steel? What is your problem with comic book movies? Why can't you do that? What is your deal?
Well, because they, for some reason, Warner Brothers Studios and DC Comics feels like they have to detach themselves from the source material. That they can't be light and fun and silly. That they all have to be the Dark Knight. And I think that's a huge mistake. It was a huge mistake with Green Lantern.
Yeah.
It was a huge mistake with Man of Steel. And I think this movie is just one more blunder after another.
It's not going to do well. The only thing I'm excited about is to see Wonder Woman and Aquaman. And
we
haven't seen anything about Aquaman yet.
Don't care about any news for this movie. Yeah. I don't care for any news for it. I mean, I'll go see it when it comes out, maybe.
But
if I hear
that
it's good,
I'll probably
go
see
it. But I'm just, you know, the news on it just makes me...
It gets to a point where you're like, when are we going to see this movie?
Yeah.
Well, and they started showing sneak peeks of it to test audiences 2 months ago, before it's done, before the script. The script isn't even finished. We don't even know how Doomsday falls into this plot line.
Do they know how Doomsday falls into this plot line?
I don't know. Could it be that Doomsday kills Superman at the end of this movie?
If they get rid of, if that's what kills Henry Cavill's contract in this, probably. If that's the only way they can get out of it, fine. But give me a break, Warner Brothers. This is ridiculous.
Yeah, it's a monumental blunder. And I love the people who are still saying, this is going to be the movie of the century.
No, it's not.
The movie to end all movies. No.
Last time I checked, that movie's coming out in December.
Yeah,
it is.
Speaking of which, Force Awakens is going to get an early release in UK and France, 2 and 3 days early to be exact. Now, our viewers asked us if this might signal an early release here in the U.S., and I'm going to say no.
No.
Why?
It's pretty much like the...
This has been
the
pattern.
Why would they do that?
And this is how Marvel and Disney is doing it now.
How? Why is... No.
Because the American market is so much bigger than Europe and Asia and everything else. They're going to throw that out there, tease it. Okay, they're going to build the... Like they need more building.
Yeah, you get those early reviews.
They get the momentum going here, and then when they open it, when it knocks what $3 billion opening weekend, that's the plan.
That makes sense, but I don't care.
Well, no, no one else do. But
they released Ant-Man 2 weeks in advance in Europe.
Yeah,
gosh.
Yeah. They released Avengers: Age of Ultron a week in advance in the overseas markets. That's their pattern now with Disney, and it's working apparently.
Yeah.
Even though, you know what, we were talking about Kevin Feige being no longer reporting the Perlmutter. I read an article since we did that episode last week. I said this was going to happen, actually claiming that Avengers: Age of Ultron was a failure at the box office. Are you kidding me? It was the second highest grossing movie of all time.
What scale are you using for failure on this one?
Because it didn't make .200 thousandths of $1 million and didn't beat the box office record of the first Avengers, so it's obviously a failure. Avengers number one, Age of Ultron number two.
I have an analogy that only I can say with in the Amy segment, so I just gotta leave it at that. That's just that.
But you want to know how big The Force Awakens is going to be?
Oh, it's going to knock all of them out of the water.
Friday, this past Friday, was Force Friday, which was just the release of the toys and the merchandise.
I have got to get one of those
remote control BB-8s.
Disney paid $4 billion for the Star Wars franchise, for Lucasfilm completely.
Yeah.
The entirety of Lucasfilm on Force Friday... they earned over $5 billion.
They paid for that on one day. Everything else from this point forward
is just profit.
Yes.
Is that not crazy?
That's insane.
Now,
it is insane to me.
A friend of mine was telling me that it reminded them of 1999 and The Phantom Menace. I don't remember the fever pitch being this big. You went and saw that with me, didn't you? That midnight show at the Indian Lake?
I think,
yeah. We had a big group. I remember there being a lot of excitement, but not like it is now.
Not like this.
And it's crazy. It does worry me that the hype is way out of proportion. And if it
won't be. It's not. It's one of those things where people are so excited for anything
I think it's going to be good. I
know it's going to be
good. Yeah, it's going to be fantastic, but it's just... there's so much that...
I think I want to cry.
When the merger and the buyout happened, it shocked everybody so hard that when they said no more, like everything is null and void on the EU, it shocked everybody so bad that everybody's like, okay, they're scrambling for new material now because everything that we grew up on is gone. So now we have to have all this new stuff that they're throwing out, which, in all honesty, killing the EU, money-wise, looks like a good idea. Because we're all scrambling for all this new stuff, because that's what's real,
uh-huh.
not the old stuff.
You
Go
mean
on,
it's
guys.
Motivated by profit?
Never, no. But still, I mean, they're giving us what the fans want to a point.
For the record, I love profit.
Oh, yeah.
I am a shameless capitalist. I love it. Anyway.
I'm not anti-profit.
All right, so we were asked to kind of give our thoughts about the rumor swirling around that Iron Spider, Spider-Man in the Tony Stark Iron Spider suit might appear in Captain America Civil War. Earlier this week, this was just a rumor.
Yeah.
Yesterday, a bootleg of the Civil War trailer.
I saw
hit YouTube,
half of this. I haven't watched it all the way through yet.
And guess what you see in the trailer?
It's Iron Spider.
He will be in the...
So is the Iron Spider, is that a real comic book character? Or?
Well, yeah, it's Spider-Man. And in the comic series Civil War, Tony Stark kind of...
convinces Parker.
To join his side.
Okay.
And he gives Peter Parker a new spider suit that enhances his natural abilities and gives him some additional abilities. And it's... red and yellow, like the Iron Man suit, so it's often referred to as the Iron Spider.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was actually a really cool design.
It was a cool design.
I liked it a lot.
Design, yeah.
It is for sure going to appear. We saw it in the trailer. I think that's really cool.
I want to know how they're going to handle the angst between Peter and Tony in that, though. Because Peter was not happy.
Oh, that is cool.
Yeah. It's a neat costume.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be cool. You know, someone asked us a question about the gauntlets that Daisy is wearing as Quake in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And you know what?
I think they did a good job.
They did. I got to tell you guys the truth. I am avoiding any Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. news or spoilers.
Yeah.
Because I really want to... watch it fresh, with fresh eyes.
And I can watch it, like, now, the night that it comes on.
Yay!
And if I can't, I can DVR it. And I'm good.
Because you've got TV
She's
now.
She's got cable now.
Woo!
Yay!
Woo!
move.
Yeah, I'll still be watching it on Wednesday night after this show on Hulu. But you think they did a good job?
I think they did a good job. I mean, there's so much that in comic books and the artwork and everything else that you can't really translate very well into the real world. We've seen people try and it just looks bad. They tried and did what they could and it looks good.
Cool.
I like it.
I'm really excited about it because the few trailers I have seen, we know that Daisy, formerly known as Sky, is leading a new team of superhumans that includes Lincoln, the Electro Boy, the Inhuman, Mac, who didn't start out with superpowers, but he was exposed to something in one of the later episodes, and he might still have something alien inside him. It'll be interesting to see. Mockingbird and Hunter.
Yes.
Now, what I would love to see is Deathlok join that
team.
Yeah.
Deathlok would be awesome on that one. Yeah.
And maybe see a few other, you know, superhumans from the secret. They're calling them the Secret Warriors, which was the comic series. And so, good stuff, man. I can't wait. I can't wait to see it. All right. So, Harley Quinn news. Paul Dini, who is actually a friend of mine, his wife Misty Lee is a fellow magician, and she plays Zatanna on stage a lot. Paul, Misty, love you guys. He said he loves Margot Robbie's Suicide Squad look as Harley Quinn.
I like it, too.
I do, too.
I like it. Everybody, I like the dirty, grungy type look. I like it. It's not cartoony, you know?
Well, because Harley came out in the Batman animated series back in, what, 95, 96?
Yep, designed by Bruce Timm.
Yeah.
Created by Timm and Dini.
Which, great character choice. Awesome deal, but it's gotten so entrenched into that look that when you want to get creative, it's almost like you don't want to make the hard work guys mad, but as a creative individual, you don't want to get stuck in that box for having the black and red jumpsuit with the diamonds down her leg.
Yeah.
You don't want to do something different. I like what they did. I like what I've seen character-wise, and she's a fantastic actress. She was awesome in Wolf on Wall Street. She was brilliant in that. But I'm digging it. I'm actually getting I'm more excited about this movie than I am Batman vs. Superman.
Yeah, me too.
Well, rumor has it that Ben Affleck appears.
Oh yeah, he does. He's hanging. They've already got pictures of him hanging on the top of Joker's purple car or whatever he is.
Yeah,
and he's dragging him down there. So
I think I've seen that.
It's like the chrome purple and green wheels car.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it's already. He's in the movie. We don't know what level or aspect he is, but
it might be just for that split second.
It might be for that cameo.
I think the Joker is the villain in this movie, right?
I don't know.
I get that impression.
I get that impression, he's the villain. It may be Batman went to catch him and caught Harley instead, and that's why she's in jail, and the Joker...
Well, the whole idea of the Suicide Squad is they are criminals.
Yes, they're all criminals.
But
they've been recruited to be heroes.
Right.
Just because they don't need anywhere.
Well, because they kind of had that in Arrow, too, didn't they? Mm-hmm. Okay.
A little bit, but not... Yeah. This level.
Well, and a little bit in The Flash, you know, they recruited Captain Cold and Heatwave. They're going to be part of the Legends of Tomorrow team. So there's
so many teams.
Themes going on.
Yeah.
Well, and here's where Marvel is doing it right. Everything is connected. Mm-hmm. TV, Netflix, movies, all connected, one universe.
Yeah.
It's where... You know, something just occurred to me, and I'll come back to this in a minute, but DC has the TV universe, the movie universe, the comic universe, and the animated universes.
Yeah.
And none of them intersect.
It's almost like...
They should just go off of Daredevil, what they've done with
series. The way I look at it, because Marvel embraced, because they tried... Back with Blade and the early Spider-Man and that kind of stuff, they kind of kept it separate.
Yeah, they did.
They kind of did. And you're like, it didn't really work.
They had to because they were beholden to other movie studios.
Marvel's done it right because they've gotten almost all of the rights back under one umbrella. And now you've got all the Daredevil stuff. You've got everything that's so interactive, and you can sit there and say, I went and saw that movie, but there's the Easter egg for that series, and that comic book did that, and they're going to do this over here and this back over here. And it's just, Marvel's doing a lot better. They're
it
a lot
flows
more
really good.
Fluid, and they're embracing everything that we all are into a lot more than DC, because DC seems to be like the old world guys.
Very disjointed.
Yeah. And the biggest thing I've ever seen, the biggest difference that I can tell, is between the two right now with everything, when the trailer leaked for Batman Superman, DC did this whole long lawyer speak explanation and why they took it down and everything else. Marvel had something leak. They put a tweet out and went, damn it, Hydra. That was it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're doing it better.
Yeah.
They're
Marvel's doing it better.
Fans.
Yes.
To the point that Chris Evans stated this week that he is willing to play Captain America as long as they want him to.
Yep, because he was under contract. His contract was coming up soon.
And just a year ago, he was saying, after Avengers Infinity, I'm done. Not just with Captain America, but with acting.
Yeah.
I'm going to go do directing, and I'm not going to act anymore. And now he's totally changed his tune, because not only is Marvel putting out great product, they're treating their people
well,
really well.
Finally,
and it makes it fun for them, and they want to come back.
They're treating the people that are defining their brand well now, because Terrence Howard got treated like crap. He went deuces. I'm done. So now they're going to take care of the people that are making what's so fantastic about this. They're going to treat them right, and hey, guess what? It's just going to blossom. It's going to be fantastic. You're going to blow DC out of the water.
Do you know what just occurred to me?
Hmm.
I think the Star Wars Expanded Universe may have been the first original contingent cross-platform universe.
Because you had the games. You had that Shadows of the Empire thing you had the whole time.
Yeah, the comics, the books, and they all tied into the movies.
Yeah.
That is a little bit sad that they did away with all that.
But see,
they're doing it all over again.
They're doing it all over again. They're making it better personally, because now you have all the ability to do, because you have all of those talented people in Disney. Yes, it is a monster company, and all they are, honestly, are about making money, but what company is it? But they've got Pixar. They've got Marvel. They've got Star Wars.
They've got the
Muppets stuff now. They've got everything that they can sit there and pull from all of these different people and all these different genres of. But they have all these talents in it. And they're just going to say, hey, have fun with that. See what comes up.
And here's the cool... This isn't even on our show notes. We're going off script, folks.
Yeah, this is a tangent. Don't mind this.
Here's the cool thing about Disney. All right. So as a creative person, as someone who has to make a living being creative in a commercial way, I love what Disney does.
Oh, absolutely.
I think they do it right. I know a lot of people have a lot of angst and animosity against the big mouse and whatnot, yada, yada, yada. That's fine. But you cannot deny the fact that they produce some great quality, iconic stuff that, quite honestly, defines our generations.
Not even generations.
Not our generation, our generations before us. Our children to come, it's amazing stuff.
It defines a mindset, not just from, you're introduced to it as Mickey, like as Steamboat Willie or Mickey Mouse when you're four or two. From that point on, your mindset is kind of set up to where the Disney stuff kind of, I don't want to say controls, but shapes your mindset to everything.
That is the big mouse, but
anyway.
But here's the thing about this. Since Disney owns all of those properties, we're seeing it with Marvel Comics, with Big Hero 6.
Oh, I love that movie.
There's some mingling. Some mingling of the properties and of the worlds. And now there's some rumors that some Pixar and Marvel stuff is going to start crossing
That's
over.
That's going to be awesome.
And we've got all of this potential.
There's so much there.
What if that galaxy far, far away
got moved?
Or someone time traveled to it? Or Dr. Pym discovered it through passing through the microverse?
What? No.
Oh, God.
Or it may be the microverse.
Do you understand the
potential?
Oh gosh, that would.
This is what's gonna blow your mind, and we're gonna close the show with this. Warner Brothers, who we've been ragging here, is for sale.
I wonder who's last
year. Well, last year, Fox, Rupert Murdoch's company, made a bid to buy it, and it didn't go through. Second in line, in negotiations right now, is Disney to buy Warner Brothers.
Who has, hang on. Who has the rights, the movie rights and everything for DC? Who has that right now?
Warner Brothers. But not only that.
Not touching that at all.
Not only that. Warner Brothers owns Hanna-Barbera and all of their properties. It owns Filmation and all of its properties.
Oh my gosh.
It owns the Max Fleischer Studios and all of their character properties. Can you imagine the juggernaut that Disney would be in the entertainment? And still not even a monopoly.
No.
Because you've still got Viacom and Paramount and Fox out there. I mean, just.
Oh my gosh, that would, that.
Yeah.
Forget it. It would be awesome. Monster. That would be fantastic.
Here's all I want to see. I want to see the Blue Falcon and Birdman and Space Ghost team up with anyone from the DC or Marvel universe.
I want to see Marvel versus DC.
Oh, that would be awesome.
Because I've got somewhere, I have to find
Avengers versus JLA.
I've got the number one Marvel versus DC somewhere.
The amalgamation years,
I have the first one somewhere. I have to find it.
Yeah, that would be great. Anyway. Well, hey, listen, we're going to sign out. Amy and Sully aren't with us this week. Dee and Nancy aren't with us this week. I told you, Labor Day wonked up everything.
Messed everything up.
So we won't have weekly rundown tonight. We won't have a cosplay moment. But stick around because we do have a special guest that's going to be joining us in just a little bit, a fellow Nashville author. And do you have hot picks tonight?
I've got a couple of hot picks. It won't be fine. It'll be quick.
All right. So stick around. Check out those additional shows tonight. And you can watch them on replay on YouTube. You got something else?
No, I'm good.
Okay. And eventually, Leanna's going to be posting some Darth Lee Sith Happens episodes.
Mm-hmm.
She's been working on them. We just got to give her a goose to get them uploaded.
Yeah.
And that'll be fun. We want to thank our sponsors, Comic Bento. Comic Bento delivers a bento box of graphic novels every month for less than $20. Click on the show notes. Click their link and check them out, and that'll be awesome. We also want to thank GraphicPolicy.com for hosting the show and helping us get the word out. We love you guys. You're awesome. And Comic City Conventions. They're the ones who put on the Nashville Comic and Toy Show, the Jackson Comic and Toy Show. You can find them at ComicCityTN.com this Saturday in Jackson, Tennessee. You don't want to miss it. It's going to be an epic show, and our crew is going to be hosting the cosplay contest, and you want to be there for that. Well, that's it.
That's it.
That's all we got for tonight. Hope you guys enjoyed the show. If you do, tell 200-300 of your closest friends and family. And until the next time, swing hard, swing often. We'll catch you on the flip side. I guess I got to turn off
the camera
myself.
Skeleton crew.
I don't get it.